thank you very much for the introduction. And let me also thank Lucia, Manuel, and Juan for this kind invitation. I'm really glad to give this talk in this series of seminars. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about today is about non-local interaction problems. So non-local interaction systems are usually systems made of many particles where you somehow give a description of particles at the continuum level, so in terms of density of particles. And those systems are called, well, non-local interaction systems because typically each particle can interact not only with particles in its immediate neighborhood, but also with particles that are far away. And examples of these systems can be found in many different applications. So for instance, in biology, in the study of population dynamics, in physics, and a well-known example is that of interaction of vortices in the Ginzburg-Landau theory for superconductors, and in material science too. And in fact, the starting point of our work is a model coming from material science, so more precisely from dislocation theory. And one of the main features of this model is that the interaction is anisotropic. And I stress this because we will see that a typical assumption in the mathematical literature about non-local interactions is the radial symmetry of the interaction. And so this is not going to be satisfied in our model, in our case. And then I'll try to build on this example to understand more in general how the anisotropy may affect the optimal distribution of particles at equilibrium. So this is a sort of, let's say, of introduction and plan of the talk. And now let me be more specific, and let me first introduce the mathematical problem, and then I'll give you some motivation in the next two slides. So the problem is, consists in minimizing this energy I in the class of probability measures in the plane. So here, mu represents the density of particles, so at a continuum level. And given a certain distribution of particles, the energy corresponding to this distribution is given by this expression. So the first term of the energy is the non-local interaction energy, and it's a convolution type integral. So if you want, maybe I can write it here, you can rewrite this energy as the integral on R2 of the convolution of W with mu, and then you take integration with respect to mu. So it's a convolution type of integral. And let me erase this, because otherwise it's not very clear what is written behind. And so the function W, the interaction kernel, has a very specific structure coming from dislocation theory. So it's given by the two-dimensional Coulomb kernel, which is minus the logarithm, plus this anisotropic term. So here, x1 is the first coordinate of x. X is a point in R2. So maybe let me erase what I added here. Okay. And the second term of the energy is called the confinement. And it involves a function v, which typically goes to infinity at infinity faster than the logarithm. So just to fix the ideas, you can think of v as a power law. So for instance, modulus of x squared, or v could be the indicator function of a compact set. So what I mean is that v is zero on a certain compact set, and it is plus infinity outside the set. And so in this case, when you minimize this energy, you can basically drop this term, but now your measures are constrained to be supported on this given compact set. So from a mathematical point of view, what is the behavior of this energy? Well, we can observe that the interaction kernel is singular at zero because of the logarithm. So it goes to plus infinity as x tends to zero. And so this means that, well, the energy will become very large when particles are very close to each other. So in other words, because of this singular behavior, we have that particles tend to repel each other when they are too close. But on the other hand, at infinity, what prevails in the energy is the confinement, V. And so this prevents particles to spread around in the plane. So the overall behavior of the energy turns out to be repulsive at short distances because of the logarithmic singularity and attractive at larger distances because of the confinement. And actually, this repulsive attractive behavior is rather typical in this kind of non-local interaction problems. So for instance, in applications to biology, where now particles are individuals, and in many biological systems, you have that, well, on the one hand, individuals tend to repel each other, so they don't want to be too close to each other, especially nowadays with the social distancing, but in general, they don't want to be too close to each other to avoid collision. But on the other hand, there is an attractive behavior at larger distances in the sense that individuals want to somehow aggregate into groups, into cohesive groups. So this is a rather typical behavior in this kind of systems. So what is new here is the presence of the anisotropy in the interaction. So clearly this anisotropy does not change the singularity at zero, which is still that of the logarithm, doesn't change the behavior at infinity, which is given by the confinement, but we will see that the presence of this anisotropy will have a very strong effect on the shape of the minimizer. And this is exactly what we would like to understand better. So how does the anisotropy may change the structure of the minimizer? Okay, now let me give you some motivation for the study of this problem. So I mentioned that the energy I of the previous slide is, well, gives a description at the continuum level. You can make this statement rigorous in the following sense, that you can describe the problem at a discrete level. So you can describe your particles as points located at some locations in the plane. And then you can define an energy at a discrete level, which is now a function of the locations of the particles. And this is basically a discrete version of the energy I. And now what you can prove is that as n tends to infinity, so the number of particles tends to infinity, then these discrete energies converge to the functional I of the previous slide. And you can prove this in the sense of gamma convergence. So this guarantees that, if you are able to understand, to identify the minimizers of I, then you have a description of the minimizers at the discrete level when n, the number of particles, is big enough. And in this context, I is called the mean field limit of the discrete energies. Okay, now let me just say a couple of words about these locations. So this is the physical motivation somehow behind the study of this very specific problem. So what are these locations? Well, these locations are line defects, so one-dimensional defects in the crystalline structure of a metal. And they are very much studied both by mathematicians and mechanicians because they are considered to be one of the main mechanisms for producing plastic deformations, so for permanent deformations in metals. And well, in this picture, you can see an example of these defects. Here is an example of a dislocation of edge type. So here you have an atomic lattice with some distortion, and the distortion is due to some extra amount of atoms. So more precisely, we have this extra half-plane of atoms that produces a local distortion of the lattice. And well, the distortion is somehow localized around this line. So this is the line going through this point and orthogonal to your screen. So this is this line of atoms. This is what is called the dislocation line. So the line defect in this particular case. So now if we assume that all defects are of this kind with straight and parallel lines, then well, we can describe the behavior of these defects in a two-dimensional setting. So we can imagine to take a two-dimensional section of the crystal. And so in this two-dimensional section, we can identify each dislocation line with its intersection with a section, so with a point. And so it's because of these geometrical assumptions that we can now describe dislocations as points, as interacting points in a two-dimensional domain. Actually, I'm going to consider a further simplification. More precisely, I'm going to assume that all dislocations have the same Burgers vector, E1. They are all positive. They have the same sign. So this means basically that this extra half-plane of atoms producing the defects are all in the top part of the crystal. Okay, so now in this setting, so now because of these geometric assumptions, dislocations are points in the plane. And now I would like to compute the interaction force between two dislocations. And one can do that in a so-called semi-discrete setting. So this means that I assume to be at a scale where I forget somehow about the details of the lattice. So I average out the details of the lattice, but I still see dislocations as points in this two-dimensional domain. So I still have a discrete description of the dislocations, but the advantage is that I can use a continuum model, a continuum mechanical model outside these locations. And so if, for instance, I consider linear elasticity as a continuum model outside these locations, I can compute the force, the interaction force between two dislocations in the plane. So assume to have a dislocation located at zero, and let us compute the force that the dislocation located at zero generates on another dislocation located at x. So in this setting, you can compute this force, and you find out that the force can be written in terms of a potential W, which is exactly the kernel that I've introduced in the previous slide. So this is just somehow to say that this very precise expression comes from mechanical consideration in this geometrical setting. Okay, now, well, there is a mechanical conjecture saying that so under these assumptions, dislocations at equilibrium should arrange themselves in such a way to form vertical alignments, which are called vertical walls of dislocations. And we can have somehow an idea on why this should be true by looking at the expression of this force. So the force up to this constant, this is a positive constant depending on the material we are considering, is given by minus the gradient of the kernel. So the force has two components, one coming from the gradient of the logarithm and one coming from the gradient of the anisotropy. So in this picture, you can see the representation of this force. So the component of the force due to the gradient of the logarithm is represented by the red arrows. So here I have a dislocation at zero, and this is a component of the force that a dislocation at x feels because of the dislocation at zero. So this component has a radial direction and it is repulsive with respect to the dislocation at zero. So this is exactly the repulsive behavior of the logarithm I was mentioning before. So this is going to be compensated by the confinement which is not represented in this picture, but of course it's in the energy. And then we have a second component of the force due to the gradient of the anisotropy. This is represented by the blue arrows. And as you can see, this is a force pointing towards the vertical axis. And so if we have a dislocation at x, because of the dislocation at zero, this will feel a force pushing it on top or on bottom of the dislocation at zero. So somehow the force due to the anisotropy pushes these locations, somehow favors the alignment, the vertical alignment of these locations. So now this picture, well, suggests that the conjecture, well, should be, well, there are good reasons why the conjecture should be true, but what we try to do is to, well, prove this conjecture rigorously. Can we prove this conjecture rigorously from a mathematical point of view? So in particular, in the case of many dislocations, this corresponds to proving that the minimizers of the energy at the continuum level have a one-dimensional vertical support. So this is what we would like to prove. And well, what is known about this problem in the literature? Well, if we forget for a moment about the anisotropy, so let's get rid of the anisotropy just for a moment, and let us consider purely Coulomb interaction. Well, then it turns out that the minimization of this energy is a very classical problem in potential theory, which goes back at least to Gauss in the framework of electrostatics. So this corresponds to finding the optimal distribution of positive charges into a capacitor or under the action of an external field, which is what I called the confinement. So actually, this problem arises in many different applications, so not only in electrostatics, but in many different fields. And here, well, is a partial list of applications and of authors that have worked, who have worked on that. So what is known from a mathematical point of view? Well, we have this result by Frostman saying that if the confinement V is lower semi-continuous and grows faster than the logarithm at infinity, then you can show that the minimization problem for this energy has a unique solution, which is compactly supported. And moreover, for a few choices of the confinement, you can characterize explicitly the minimizer. So in particular, if V is modulus of X squared, you can show that the minimizer of this energy is given by this measure, which is called the circle law. So this is the measure supported on the unit disk centered at zero with uniform density given by one over the area of the disk. So this is the result in the case of purely Coulomb interaction. And now what is known about more general interaction problems? Well, the literature, the mathematical literature on nonlocal interaction is really huge, but basically the results can be subdivided into two different groups. So the first group of results is about the explicit characterization of the minimizer, which is called the equilibrium measure in this context. And a good reference is the book by Safet Otik on potential theory. So these are explicit characterization of the minimizer in the same spirit as Frostman result. But these explicit characterizations are only available for the Coulomb interaction kernel. So not only in 2D, also in higher dimension, and for confinements that are radially symmetric. And the reason is that, well, these explicit characterizations are strongly based on the fact that the Coulomb kernel is the fundamental solution of the Laplacian and on the radial symmetry assumption. And then, well, the second group of results is about much more general interaction kernels. And the goal here is to establish qualitative properties of minimizers. And here the literature is really vast, and this is a very partial list of authors who have contributed to that. But again, a typical assumption in many of these papers is radial symmetry, which is something that we do not have. And well, concerning a dimension of the support of the minimizer, so we would like to prove the mechanical conjecture. So we are interested in characterizing the dimension of the support of the minimizer. Well, the only paper we are aware of so about dimensionality is this contribution by Balaguer, Carillo, Laurent, and Raoul, where well, they give a lower bound on the dimension, house dimension of the support of the minimizer. So it's not a characterization of the dimensionality, it's only a lower bound. And well, moreover, it does not apply, unfortunately, to the critical logarithmic singularity that we have at zero. So basically, because of the critical logarithmic singularity that we have on one hand and of the anisotropy that we have on the other hand, our kernel does not fit into any of these two frameworks, into any of these two groups of results. So somehow the presence of the anisotropy really is really somehow something new from this point of view. So nevertheless, we were able to prove the following result. So this is joint with Luca Rondi and Lucia Scardia. So let us consider the interaction kernel, I mean, the one coming from this location theory. So now the anisotropy is back into the interaction kernel. So what we can show is that well, is a result in the spirit of Frostmann result, but now with the anisotropy in the interaction. So if the confinement is lower semi-continuous and grows faster than the logarithm at infinity, we can again show that the minimizer of this energy exists, is unique, and is compactly supported. And in the Frostmann case, so when V is modulus of X squared, we can characterize explicitly the minimizer. And the minimizer is given by this measure, which has a completely different structure from the circle law. So the minimizer found by Frostmann for the purely logarithmic interaction. And more precisely, the minimizer that we have corresponds to the so-called semicircle law on the vertical axis. So this measure is given by the product of the Dirac delta at zero on x1 with respect to x1 times this measure of x2. So the support of this measure, oh, sorry, I think there is no, oh, okay. So the support of this measure is, okay. So is this segment minus square root of two on the vertical axis. So it's a one-dimensional vertical support, and the density is not constant, but it's given by 1 over pi times this function. So if you draw a graph of this function, you get a semicircle, and this is why the name. So, well, this result proves that at least for this choice of the confinement, the mechanical conjecture is true. So we do see vertical alignments of these locations at equilibrium. And well, from a mathematical point of view, this result shows how the anisotropy may completely change the structure of the minimizer. So if there's no anisotropy, the minimizer is supported on a two-dimensional set with uniform density. In the presence of the anisotropy, we get a one-dimensional support and non-uniform density. So we were somehow intrigued by this phenomenon, and so we tried to understand a little bit better how this drop of dimensionality occurs. And so in order to do so, so to understand better how the drop of dimensionality occurs, we introduced the following auxiliary, the following family of energies. So the confinement is still given by modulus of x squared, but now we have a parameter alpha in front of the anisotropy in such a way to tune the strength of this anisotropic kernel into the interaction. And well, here, in principle, you can consider any value of the parameter, but for simplicity, let me consider the case where the parameter alpha is in between 0 and 1. So what I would like to do here is, well, to understand, well, to see if I can characterize explicitly the minimizers for alpha in between 0 and 1, and I would like to see what happens to their dimensionality. So what is the dimension of their support, of the support of the minimizers? Okay, well, it turns out that for what concerns existence of a minimizer and a compact support of the minimizers, well, this is rather standard. I mean, here we can apply the general standard theory of nonlocal interaction problems. And so the fact that we have the anisotropy is not really relevant to prove existence of a minimizer and to show that minimizers are compactly supported. So for existence, you just apply the direct method of the calculus of variations. And to prove that minimizers are compactly supported, well, this basically comes from the confinement that prevails at infinity. But this is really somehow standard. We can apply the general theory for nonlocal interactions. So what is less standard is a uniqueness of the minimizer. And well, this result, well, together with the characterization of the minimizer now in the presence of the parameter alpha, is a joint work with José Antonio Carillo, Joan Mateu, Luca Rondi, Lucia Scardia, and Joan Verdera. So this part about tuning the anisotropy is joint with these co-authors. So uniqueness is in general not easy to prove for these problems. And in this case, it comes from the following lemma. So let us consider two probability measures having a finite interaction energy and compact support. And let us look at the interaction on the difference of the two measures. Then you can show that the interaction energy on the difference has a sign, is always non-negative, and actually is strictly positive if the two measures are different. Now, from this lemma, it's not difficult to show that the energy is strictly convex, at least on the class of measures having these two properties, finite interaction energy and compact support. But we know that minimizers have these two properties, and so strict convexity on this class is enough to have uniqueness of the minimizer. Okay, let me just say a couple of words about the proof of this lemma. So the heuristic idea is to prove this lemma is to write the interaction energy in terms of the Fourier transforms in such a way that the convolution becomes a product. And now, since here we have the square of the Fourier transform of nu, to prove that this have a sign, we just need to show that the Fourier transform of the kernel is positive. So you can compute the Fourier transform of the kernel. Actually, this is not positive. The Fourier transform of the kernel is not positive, but you have positivity if you restrict to the class of test functions satisfying this additional condition that they are zero at zero. So on these test functions, the Fourier transform of the kernel reduces to this expression, where, well, you can check that this is a positive function as long as these two coefficients are positive. So in other words, for alpha in between minus one and one, and this is okay for our case. And well, positivity on the class of test functions satisfying this additional condition is enough because if you look here, well, here our nu is the difference of two probability measures. So the integral of nu on the whole plane is zero. And so this implies that the Fourier transform of nu is zero at zero. So in other words, here we have as a test function, something which is positive and which is zero at zero. So positivity on this class of test functions is enough to conclude. And this is basically the idea behind the dilemma, behind the proof. And let me just mention, because I will go back to this point at the end of the talk, that alpha equal to one, and actually symmetrically alpha equal to minus one, are somehow values of the parameter for which we have some degeneracy of the Fourier transform. So for alpha equal to one or alpha equal to minus one, we lose, in a sense, coercivity of this quadratic form at the numerator. So I'll go back to this remark at the end of the talk. So let's just keep in mind that one and minus one are sort of critical values for the Fourier transform. Okay, so at this stage, we know that the minimizer for this functional I alpha exists, is unique, and it has a compact support. So can we identify the minimizer in any way? Well, here we proved that the energy is convex. So we know that minimality is equivalent to the Euler-Lagrange conditions. So the first order necessary conditions for minimality are in this case equivalent to minimality because of convexity of the energy. So what is the form of the Euler-Lagrange conditions? Well, it's the following. So the Euler-Lagrange conditions take this form. So they are given in terms of two conditions. So the first condition is an equality that must be satisfied in the support of the candidate minimizer, mu. So while the other condition is an inequality that must be satisfied elsewhere. So the first condition says that this function, which we can call the potential function, so it's the convolution of the kernel with the candidate minimizer. So this function plus one half the confinement has to be constant in the support of the measure. And well, the second condition says that the same function has to be above this same constant elsewhere in the plane. So the value of the constant is not prescribed a priori. So if you are able to find any measure, any probability measure, satisfying these two conditions for some constant, then this measure has to be the unique minimizer of the energy because of convexity. So the question is, well, can we find a measure satisfying these two conditions for some constant C alpha? Well, and this is the main result that we proved together with, well, José Antonio Carillo, Joan Mateu, Luca Rondi, Lucia Scardia, and Joan Verdera. So the result is the following. So let us consider the measure given by the following expression. So this is a measure whose support is given by the closure of this set. So this is a two-dimensional ellipse centered at the origin with the semi-axis given by these two numbers. And the density of this measure is constant and given by one over the area of the ellipse. So what we can show is that this measure satisfies the two Euler-Lagrange conditions for some constants. And so this measure has to be the unique minimizer of the energy I alpha. So the global picture is the following. So if we don't have anisotropy, then the minimizer is given by the uniform distribution on the unit disk. When we add some anisotropy into the problem, then, well, we still have a uniform distribution on a two-dimensional set, which is now an ellipse, a bit elongated vertically. And then as we increase the anisotropy, the distribution stays uniform on an ellipse, which is more and more elongated vertically as alpha approaches one. And it's only at alpha equal to one that somehow those ellipses get squeezed onto the vertical axis and we obtain the semicircle law as a minimizer. And well, the situation is completely symmetric for alpha negative. So for alpha in between minus one and zero, we get a uniform distribution on a two-dimensional ellipse, which is elongated horizontally. And at alpha equal to minus one, we get the semicircle law on the horizontal axis. Okay, so now in the remaining time, I would like to give you just an idea of the proof of this theorem. So, well, what we need to do is to show that this measure satisfies these two conditions. Well, the first condition is an equality inside the ellipse. So, well, here we need the explicit expression of this potential function. So this is an equality, so we need the exact expression of this potential function inside the ellipse. While, well, to prove the second condition, this is an inequality. So here, well, maybe bounds and, well, estimates on this potential function may be enough. Okay, so how do we proceed? Well, let me first introduce some notation. So I'm going to write the kernel as the logarithmic kernel plus alpha the anisotropic kernel. And I'm going to denote by mu AB the measure supported on an ellipse of semi-axis A and B and with constant density given by 1 over the area of the ellipse. Okay, so now what we need to prove the first Euler Lagrange condition is the explicit expression of the potential for a measure of this kind inside the ellipse. Well, the good news is that the logarithmic part of the potential, so the convolution of the logarithm with the characteristic function of an ellipse, is explicit. So there is an explicit formula for the logarithmic potential of an ellipse. This is due to Kirchhoff and is actually a well-known formula in the context of fluid mechanics. So the logarithmic part is known. We need to compute the anisotropic part of the potential. Well, it turns out that somehow our anisotropy is related in a sense to the Coulomb kernel, in the sense that if, for instance, we compute the Laplacian of the anisotropic kernel, we see that this Laplacian, well, it has some singularity at zero, and then it involves second derivatives of the Coulomb kernel. So if we compute the Laplacian of the anisotropic potential of mu, using this formula, we get this constant times mu, and then, well, second derivatives of the logarithmic potential. So now if we are inside the ellipse, well, inside the ellipse, the distribution is uniform, so mu is constant. And, well, from Kirchhoff formula, you can see that the logarithmic potential of the characteristic function of an ellipse is a polynomial of degree 2 inside the ellipse. So here we are taking second derivatives. So this term turns out to be a constant as well inside the ellipse. So in other words, the Laplacian of the anisotropic potential turns out to be constant inside the ellipse, and the same is true for the Laplacian of the logarithmic potential, since, as I said, this is a polynomial of degree 2 inside the ellipse. So in other words, the potential of the convolution function, of the potential function, is an explicit constant inside the ellipse. So on the other hand, again, using the explicit expression of the anisotropy, we can compute the gradient of the potential function on the boundary of the ellipse. So on the potential function, we know the Laplacian inside the ellipse, we know its gradient on the boundary of the ellipse. This is enough to characterize clearly the potential inside the ellipse. And actually, the Laplacian is constant. You can also check from the formula that we get that the gradient turns out to have a linear dependence on x on the boundary. So you can actually guess what the expression of the potential is. It turns out to be quadratic inside the ellipse. And so, in other words, by using this sort of overdetermined problem, we can deduce an explicit formula for the potential of an ellipse inside the ellipse. Actually, we can do that for any ellipse, whatever the semi-axis are. And so now, using the explicit formula, we can impose the first Euler Lagrange condition. So we impose that the potential plus one half the confinement has to be constant inside the ellipse. And by imposing this condition, we find a unique pair of semi-axes satisfying the condition. And so we find the value of the two semi-axes. Okay, so now we need to show the second Euler-Lagrange condition, so the inequality outside the ellipse. So let me call u alpha the function that somehow is involved in the Euler-Lagrange equations. Now we know that this function is constant inside the ellipse, and we need to show that this function is above this constant outside the ellipse. So somehow the idea here is to use a sort of maximum principle, but unfortunately this function u alpha is not harmonic outside the ellipse, is biharmonic. And so we cannot really apply the maximum principle, but we can argue in the following way. So since we know from the first Euler-Lagrange conditions that this function is constant inside the ellipse, we just need to prove this inequality, we just need to show that the function u alpha is increasing along any normal ray to the boundary of the ellipse. So let's take a point, why not, outside the ellipse. Let us denote by x naught its projection on the boundary of the ellipse, and let mu be the normal vector to the boundary of the ellipse at x naught. So if we are able to show that the normal derivative of u alpha at y naught is non-negative, then we are done. I mean, if we can prove that at every point y naught outside the ellipse, then this is telling us that u alpha is increasing along this normal array. This can be done for every y naught, and so the inequality is satisfied because u alpha is constant with the right value on the ellipse. So unfortunately, as I was mentioning, the function u alpha is not harmonic, is actually biharmonic outside the ellipse. And this can be deduced again using the explicit expression of the potential of the anisotropic part. So how can we somehow proceed here? Well, the idea here actually comes from a paper by Duffin in 1961. So if you have a biharmonic, so what Duffin shows is that if you have a biharmonic function, well, you can state some sort of maximum principle in terms of suitable auxiliary functions. So what I mean is the following. Let us introduce a function g, the function g given by this expression. So here, y naught and nu are fixed, and so x is the variable. Well, you can show that when u alpha is biharmonic, and this is true for us outside the ellipse, then this function g turns out to be harmonic in the same set. So g is harmonic outside the ellipse. So to g, we can apply the maximum principle. So let's have a look at the behavior of G on the boundary of this set. Well, at infinity, one can show that in U alpha, what prevails is the confinement. So one can check that the behavior of G at infinity is given by the following constant, which is strictly positive. So we have positivity at infinity. On the other hand, on the boundary of the ellipse, we can use the first Euler-Lagrange condition. So we know that u alpha is constant inside the ellipse. U alpha is a C1 on the whole plane. So its gradient is zero on the ellipse and on the boundary of the ellipse as well. So this normal derivative is zero on the boundary of the ellipse. So g on the boundary of the ellipse reduces to this expression, where this quantity is non-negative using the convexity of the set of the ellipse. So if we are able to show that the Laplacian of u alpha is positive on the boundary of the ellipse, then we have positivity of g on the boundary of omega alpha, positivity at infinity, g is harmonic, and so we can conclude by the maximum principle that G is positive everywhere outside the ellipse. So in particular, G is positive at Y naught, But at y naught, g reduces to the normal derivative of u alpha at y naught, which is therefore positive. And this is exactly what we wanted to prove. So to conclude, one has only to show this sign condition on the Laplacian, and this can be proved using the expression of the Laplacian of the anisotropic kernel and the explicit expression of the logarithmic potential for an ellipse, which is the Kirchhoff formula. So this is somehow the idea of the proof of this result. And now if I have just a couple of minutes, okay, I would like to discuss a little bit the interplay between degeneracy, so loss of dimensionality of the minimizer and degeneracy of the Fourier transform that I mentioned before. So we have seen that alpha equal to one and symmetrically alpha equal to minus one are, values of the parameter at which we have a sudden loss of dimensionality. And I've shown you before that those two values correspond to a degeneracy of the Fourier transform. So we lose somehow coercivity in a sense. And or if you prefer, you can look at the associated differential operator. So the differential operator associated to our kernel, and which is the following. So the bi-Laplacian of the kernel can be written in terms of anisotropic Laplacian of the Dirac delta. So as alpha, when alpha is in between minus one and one, here on the right-hand side, we have a non-degenerate operator. This operator becomes degenerate when alpha is equal to one or minus one. So the question is, is there a relation between these two facts? Can we maybe establish a general principle relating degeneracy of the Fourier transform and loss of dimensionality? So we tried, to understand better this question, we tried to reproduce this behavior of loss of dimensionality, for instance, in higher dimensions. And a natural choice for the kernel in n dimension is the following. We replace the Coulomb kernel, the logarithmic kernel, by the Coulomb kernel in Rn, so 1 over x to the power n minus 2. And as anisotropy, we consider this kernel. Why is that? Because if you look at the Fourier transform or at the associated differential operator, you have the same kind of structure that we had in 2D, but now the critical values of the parameter are n minus 2 and minus n plus 2. Okay, for this kernel, now we are in Rn, the confinement is still modulus of x squared. What we are able to show is the following. So assume for simplicity that alpha is positive. So let's just look at alpha positive. Then we can show that the minimizer exists, is unique, and it can be characterized as the normalized characteristic function of an n-dimensional ellipsoid. So the dimension of the support is n, but this is true up to the critical value, n minus 2 included. So in other words, there is no loss of dimensionality at alpha equal to the critical value. So this example shows that at least for smooth confinements as a modulus of x squared, a degeneracy of the Fourier transform does not imply necessarily a loss of dimensionality. So what is probably true, and there are some partial results by Mattias Delgadino in this direction. So what is probably true is the converse implication. So what I mean is that probably what you can show is that as long as you don't have degeneracy, then you shouldn't have loss of dimensionality. So if your Fourier transform is non-degenerate, then your minimizer should be fully dimensional. And what I've discussed here is for the smooth confinement modulus of x squared, one could argue, what about other confinements? And The answer is that the history can be completely, the story can be completely different. So for instance, let's go back to 2D and let us consider a confinement given by the indicator function of a set. And as a set, let us consider an ellipse. So now we are minimizing the interaction energy over all measures whose support is contained in this ellipse. Well, you can characterize the minimizer also in this case, in the presence of the anisotropy. This is a joint result with Alessandro Scagliotti, who was a master student of mine here in Pavia. And what you can show is that the minimizer is supported, in this case, is supported on the boundary of the ellipse. So it's always one dimensional. So this is not surprising because at least for the logarithm, it's well known that the boundary has a very strong attractive behavior. What is more surprising is that the minimizer turns out to be the same for every value of alpha in this case. So this is clearly related to some symmetry and special property of the confinement of the ellipse, but it's rather surprising that the minimizer in this case is completely insensitive to the presence of the anisotropy. So the behavior is completely different from what we observed in the case of the smooth confinement modulus of X squared. So the conclusion is that if you change confinements, then the story can be completely different. And I stop here and I thank you very much for your attention.